He said, I know you study the Bible. I know you're into the prophecies of the Bible. I want you to tell me, is Hitler going to succeed? And so they had a little system set up in their unit that if you wanted to speak off the record without any fear of repercussions or ramifications, you would take your hat off to have the conversation. So Hazel asked his commanding officer, he says, is this an official question or an unofficial question? His commander took his hat off. He could speak freely. There is something that has stopped every would-be world ruler, every dictator over in Europe from accomplishing their designs, their plans. You know what has stopped them? Take a look at verse 43. If you go to the British Museum in London, England, and go to Persian Hall, what you will find there is something called the Cyrus Cylinder. The Cyrus Cylinder is a rock record of this very battle. What I have here is a cast from the original. This is what it looks like. This is the story of the overthrow of the Kingdom of Babylon, exactly as it appears in the Bible. Our topic tonight is the rise and fall of world empires. The year was 1948. It was an election year. The incumbent president was Harry S. Truman. His opponent was Thomas Dewey. Thomas Dewey was the governor of New York. Now, President Truman's approval rating was pretty abysmal. In fact, it was downright bad. And so going into this election, everybody knew that Dewey had it in the bag. It was just a matter of time until the votes bore that out. In fact, one newspaper, the Chicago Daily Tribune, knew without a doubt that Dewey was going to win. And so they wanted to get ahead of their competitors, ahead of their opponents, and they went to the presses to announce Dewey's election. Well, it didn't quite turn out that way. It ended up, when all the votes had come in, that Truman actually won. But Truman got a hold of one of those copies of the Chicago Daily Tribune and with great glee held it up to show how wrong they had been. He was indeed the reelected president of the United States. You know, the future is very difficult to predict, and the future of American politics, notoriously difficult to predict. How many of you have been surprised in the last several years the way things have gone one way or the other? So, what about the future of this world, and specifically, what about the future of this country? We find that the United States is involved in many different activities around the world. We find our military engaged in Iraq, Afghanistan. Currently, we are supplying arms to Ukraine. We'll have to wait and see exactly how that all pans out. But the United States is involved in different places and some places that you and I don't even know about. But we are involved all over the world, if not militarily, then diplomatically. And there are challenges that come with that. We also face challenges in the area of, well, natural disasters. What does the future of the United States look like from that perspective? Down in the south and the east, we deal with hurricanes. Here in Tennessee, we deal with what? Tornadoes, right? How many of you even remember the tornado on Easter Sunday a few years ago? Came right through here and destroyed a lot of homes, caused a lot of damage. If you happen to live in the western part of the country, it's droughts, it's wildfires, it's earthquakes. What does the future hold for our country when we take all that into consideration? And what about crime? What about violence? How many of you remember seeing this picture before? Where was that from? You remember? Columbine, Colorado. Well, fortunately, since that took place, things have gotten a whole lot better here in the U.S., right? Or have they gotten worse? Oh, we look at Virginia Tech, we look at Sandy Hook, We look at the nightclub down in Orlando. The list grows on and on and on. It's almost gotten to the point where we go, oh, did you hear of that other shooting that just took place? I mean, it used to be that we didn't hear about these things. They've almost become commonplace today. People are not treating one another with the kindness and love and understanding that Jesus would teach us to treat one another with. Amen? So things are going in an interesting direction here in this country. But when it comes to predicting the future, there's really only one place that we can go that can forecast the future with absolute certainty. Do you know where that place is? It is the Bible. The Bible helps us to understand what the future looks like, and it hasn't been wrong yet. So we're going to take a look at some prophecies of the Bible, their when they were given, how they were fulfilled, and see whether it is indeed accurate. Now, there is one great book in the Bible in the New Testament that is often associated with or linked with prophecy. What book is that? That is the book of Revelation. So I'm going to invite you to go over to the book of Revelation with me this evening, and we're going to take a brief look at the book of Revelation because we want to be able to understand it or understand how we can understand it so that we don't get confused by it. There are a lot of misconceptions about the book of Revelation. You go to the book and you find that there are all these different beasts and symbols. There are angels and there are plagues and there's all kinds of things that cause a lot of people a lot of fear and consternation. And many people don't even want to open the book of Revelation. In fact, there are some people that teach that Revelation is a closed book and that you shouldn't even open it and try to understand it. Well, let's take a look at what the book of Revelation says about itself. We're going to turn to Revelation 1, verse 1. Revelation chapter 1, verse 1 begins with these words. It says, the revelation of who? Jesus Christ. Now, I'm going to pause right there for just a moment. It says, this is the revelation of Jesus Christ. The word revelation has a root word. What is the root word of revelation? Reveal. What does reveal mean? To show or to open or to explain or something along those lines. What would be the opposite of reveal? The opposite of reveal would be conceal or hide. So if I were to tell you this evening that I was going to reveal to you how old my wife is, what would you expect me to do? I once had somebody yell back, lie. Well, I can't very well do that. But if I was going to reveal to you how old she is, I would maybe tell you the year she was born, how many years she's lived, or something along those lines. I'm no fool. I'm not going to reveal that to you. Instead, I'm going to do the opposite. I'm going to conceal it from you. But this is not the concealing of Jesus Christ. This is the revelation or the revealing of Jesus Christ. So it says, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants things which must shortly take place. And he sent and signified it by his angel to his servant John. Now take a look at verse number 3. Verse number 3 says this, blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written in it, for the time is near, or the King James says the time is at hand. So verse 3 says, blessed is he who reads those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep the things which are written in it. In other words, the book of Revelation tells us that if we read it, hear it, keep it, we will receive a what? A blessing. How many of you, regardless of however many blessings you already may have from God, how many of you would be open to receiving an additional blessing from God? All right. He says, I want to give you a blessing. Well, how do you receive that blessing? He tells us. He says, blessed is he who does three things. Blessed is he who what? Reads those who hear the words of this prophecy. And what's the third thing? And keep those things which are written in it. So if we want to receive a blessing from God, we go to the book of Revelation, we read it. That means read it. We hear it. In other words, we listen to what it has to say, not just reading for the sake of checking it off and moving on to the next thing we have to do in life that day. We read it. We listen to it. We hear what it has to say. But then beyond that, we're not just reading and listening. What else are we doing? We are keeping it. In other words, we are putting into practice what we have learned from our study of that book. And this applies really to all the Bible if you stop and think about it. Because you know who knows the Bible a whole lot better than you or I do? The devil does. He knows the Bible really well. He's been familiar with it for thousands of years. But do you think he's going to get a blessing from it? No. Why not? What's he not doing? He's not keeping the things. He understands it. He reads it. He understands it. But he's like, I'm not keeping that. I'm going to do my own thing. But you and I, we don't want to follow him. We want to follow Jesus. Amen? So blessed is he who reads, hears, and keeps those things which are written in it. So how do we understand the book of Revelation then, as we're reading it? As I mentioned, sometimes there are things in there that are a little confusing, a little difficult to understand. But God has given us a wonderful key that can help us unlock the sometimes confusing things in the book of Revelation. Because in the Old Testament, there is another great prophetic book that is kind of like a prophetic twin of the book of Revelation. Does anybody know what book that is? That is the book of Daniel. They're like two great prophetic twins. If you're reading through the book of Revelation, and there's something that you're reading that you don't understand, 9 times out of 10, if you go over to the book of Daniel, it will help you understand what's going on in the book of Revelation. Or if you're over in the book of Daniel and you come across something that you don't understand, 9 times out of 10, if you go over to the book of Revelation, it will help you understand what's going on in the book of Daniel. So as we look at the events that are going to happen, that are happening now, that will happen in the future, as we go through this seminar, we're going to spend a fair bit of time in the book of Revelation. It deals with end time events. But of necessity, we're also going to be spending a fair bit of time in what other book? Daniel, because those two are going to unlock or help unlock one another. Now, I'm going to invite you to turn over to the book of Daniel now. But as you do that, I'm going to draw your attention to a verse or two up on the screen that applies to what we're talking about right now. In Isaiah chapter 46, verses 9 and 10, it says, "Remember the former things of old, for I am God and there is no other. I am God and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times things that are not yet done, saying my counsel shall stand and I will do all my pleasure." In other words, God, through the pages of Scripture, through the pages of the Bible, helps us to understand things that have not yet occurred. In other words, he foretells the future, and he does it with incredible accuracy. We're going to see evidence of that this evening. So as we take a look at the book of Daniel, prepare to be amazed at how accurate God is at predicting things to come. He knows the end from the beginning. So let's go to Daniel chapter 2 tonight. Daniel chapter what? Chapter 2. And as you're turning there, I'll share a little background on the book of Daniel. I want you to go back in your mind with me, in your imagination, about 2,500 years to the ancient city of Babylon, which was the capital of the kingdom of Babylon. It was located about 56 miles south of a city that we know today as Baghdad, Iraq. And in those days, Babylon was the center of really everything, the civilized world. It was an incredible city, and the king who ruled at that time was a king by the name of Nebuchadnezzar. In that city, there were over 200 gold-domed temples. The walls of the city were wide enough to race several chariots across at the same time around the city. It was an incredible city that the river Euphrates flowed through the middle of, providing an inexhaustible supply of water. There was also in the city something called the Hanging Gardens of Babylon, one of the 7 wonders of the ancient world. How many of you have heard of the Hanging Gardens of Babylon before? So the king built that for his wife, who was a country girl. And he wanted her to feel at home in the city, so he bought her, built her, the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. Does that sound like a decent gift? Not bad, right? One of the seven wonders of the ancient world. I mean, they produced so much food there that they could keep the city fed for months. They had nothing to worry about. Strong walls, inexhaustible supply of water, and just a beautiful, beautiful ability to accomplish what they wanted to. Nebuchadnezzar was a powerful, a very wise ruler who wanted his kingdom to thrive, to last forever. But one night he was sleeping, and as he slept, he had a dream. Let's take a look at this dream. Daniel chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. It says, "Now in the second year of Nebuchadnezzar's reign, Nebuchadnezzar had dreams, and his spirit was so troubled that his sleep left him." In other words, he woke up. Have you ever had a dream that was so powerful, so strong, so vivid that you woke right up out of your sleep? How many of you have had that before? Okay, that's exactly what happened to Nebuchadnezzar. But this became a big problem for his kingdom. It says in verse 2, "Then the king gave the command to call the magicians, the astrologers, the sorcerers, and the Chaldeans to tell the king his dreams. So they came and stood before the king. And the king said to them, 'I have had a dream, and my spirit is anxious to know the dream.' Then the Chaldeans spoke to the king in Aramaic, 'O king, live forever.'" That's what you'd say to a dignitary back then, right? If you wanted to get on their good side, "O king, live forever. O king, live forever. Tell your servants the dream, and we will give the interpretation." That's not very hard to do, is it? To come up with an interpretation, a pleasing interpretation based on someone else's dream. How many of you think you could do that? If somebody had a dream, you could come up with a pleasing interpretation. Think you could manage that? Not real hard. And that's what his wise men had been doing for years and years and years. But there's a problem this time. You know what the problem was? He didn't remember what his dream was. The problem was the king had forgotten his dream. So look at what happens in verses 5 and 6. In verse 5, it says, "The king answered and said to the Chaldeans, 'My decision is firm.'" The King James says, "The thing is gone from me. I don't remember what it was. 'If you do not make known the dream to me,' he says, 'then what's going to happen? In its interpretation, you shall be cut in pieces, and your houses shall be made an ash heap.'" I kind of like the King James. It says, "Your houses shall be made a dung hill." Sometimes the language in the King James is just a little more vivid. So here's what Nebuchadnezzar says. He says, "Listen, boys, I've been paying you very well, and I expect you to deliver. But if you don't tell me what I dreamed last night and interpret it, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to cut off your arms. I'm going to cut off your legs. I'm going to cut off your head. I'm going to chop you up into little bitty pieces, and I'm going to turn your house into a sewage treatment plant." Today we would refer to Nebuchadnezzar as a motivational speaker. How many of you would have been motivated, right? Now this was not a rash decree from the king. You understand that he knew if they couldn't tell him something that had happened 24 hours in the past, how would they be able to tell him something that was going to happen 24 hours in the future or 2,400 years in the future? So he realized that they had betrayed his trust, and he wanted them now to deliver or else. He says, "However, if you tell the dream and its interpretation, you shall receive from me gifts, rewards, and great honor. Therefore, tell me the dream and its interpretation." Now, when you talk about foretelling the future these days, people have all kinds of different ways that they suggest that you can find those kinds of answers. You know, maybe you go to the crystal ball gazers, the tarot card readers, those who can tell you about the zodiac and tell you your horoscope based on the positions of the stars and things like that. Now, what do you think the Bible says about this type of future telling? Does it speak very highly of it? In fact, it doesn't at all. In fact, what it tells should happen is people who engage in these sort of things, you know what it says ought to happen to them? They ought to be put to death. So this is not where we want to go. But where can we go to find an accurate picture of the future? We can indeed go to the Bible. So let's take a look at Daniel 2, verse 7. It says, they answered again and said, let the king tell his servants the dream, and we will give its interpretation. The king answered and said, I know for certain that you would gain time. What's another way of saying that? He says, I know all you're doing is you're what? You're stalling, right? I know that you want to gain time because you see that my decision is firm. If you do not make known the dream to me, there is only one decree for you, for you have agreed to speak lying and corrupt words before me till the time has changed. Therefore, tell me the dream, and I shall know that you can give me its interpretation. The Chaldeans answered the king and said, there is not a man on earth who can tell the king's matter. Therefore, no king, lord, or ruler has ever asked such things of any magician, astrologer, or Chaldean. It is a difficult thing that the king requests, and there is no other who can tell it to the king except the gods whose dwelling is not with flesh. Now, that they actually got right. Then it says, for this reason, the king was angry and very furious and gave the command to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. So the decree went out for his soldiers to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. Now, not all of the individuals who served as wise men in the kingdom of Babylon were charlatans like these individuals. There are several whose names we know who served the God of heaven. Do you know the names of those individuals? I'm thinking of four of them. What were they? Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, or their Hebrew names, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, but we usually call them or refer to them by their Babylonian names. So Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But when the decree went out, the king said, I want you to destroy how many? All of them. Now, how did Daniel and his friends get to be wise men in the pagan kingdom of Babylon? If you go back and read Daniel chapter 1, you'll find how Nebuchadnezzar's army came into Jerusalem and they slaughtered a great many people there, and they took back some of the promising young men to be retrained in the Babylonian university system and serve as advisors to the king. That was commonplace back in those days. So Daniel and his friends and a great many others were brought back to Babylon. They were trained up in the Babylonian universities, and they began to serve as advisors or wise men to the king. So as Daniel and his friends were hanging out at home one day, the guards come by his door, and they knock on the door. And Daniel opens the door and says, may I help you? And the guard says, yes, we're here to kill you. And Daniel and his friends say, hang on, time out, wait a minute, what's going on? And they ask to go see the king, to have a little bit of time. So it says in Daniel 2, verses 17 and 18, actually, let's go back. I want to take a look at verse number 16. Look at verse 16. Verse 16 says, then Daniel went in and desired of the king that he would give him what? Time, and that he would show the king the interpretation. What do you think Daniel wanted a little bit of time to do? Pray. What would you want time to do? You want to pray, right? Daniel says, let me have a little bit of time. I'm going to go home and pray, and we'll see if we can't assist you with this challenge. Then, verse 17, Daniel went to his house and made the decision known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his companions, that they might seek mercies from the God of heaven concerning this secret, so that Daniel and his companions might not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. So Daniel went back home to pray. You know, that's good advice for us, too, when we face challenges in this life. When Daniel faced challenges in his life, he prayed. But the incredible thing about Daniel was he didn't just pray when he was facing difficulties and challenges. Daniel prayed when? All the time. In fact, you read a little bit later in the story of Daniel how his regular prayers kind of got him in a little bit of hot water. A little bit, well, it wasn't hot water, it got him in a what? In a lion's den, right? Because he continued to pray as he usually did when there had been a decree passed. Daniel said, it doesn't matter to me, I'm going to continue to pray. Daniel prayed when things were going well, and Daniel prayed when things were going poorly. It didn't matter to him. He trusted God, he had a relationship with God, and he communed with him through prayer. The incredible thing is you and I can do that today with the very same God that Daniel prayed to, the very same God that Daniel prayed with. We can do the same thing. I don't know what challenges you may be facing right now. I mean, there's a high likelihood that if you are alive, if you have a heartbeat and you're breathing, you're probably facing some challenges, yes? Now, what are some challenges that people face today? Some people today are facing financial challenges. They're not as financially secure as they hoped they would be at this point in their life. Maybe they lost a lot. Maybe they have yet to try to figure out how to gain anything. Maybe they've got some loans that they're trying to pay back and they're having a hard time making those payments, or car payments, or maybe the mortgage. Every time it comes due, you're scraping to try to figure out how in the world you are going to pay that bill. Or maybe you're not able to right now and the creditors are knocking at your door and threatening to take everything from you. If you don't know how you're going to solve a problem and you've tried everything that you can think of to solve that problem financially, you know what it might be a good idea to do? Pray. Say, Lord, I'm in a fix. I don't know how to get out of this. I don't know how we're going to make ends meet. I don't know how I'm going to be able to retire the way I wanted to. I don't know, Lord, but please help. Do you think he could answer a prayer like that, yes or no? Yes, he can. Now, maybe the challenge you're facing is not financial. Maybe it's relational. Maybe you're in a relationship right now that's not going the way that you had hoped. Maybe the person that you married didn't turn out to be the person that you thought that they were. Maybe there's some abuse. Maybe there's some even worse. And you're looking at your life and you're going, how in the world am I going to deal with this? What do I do? We've tried counseling. We've tried this. We've tried that. What are we going to do? Well, maybe you've tried everything that the world has to offer. Maybe you ought to bring it to who? Bring it to God and say, Lord, here's the situation. Maybe you're worried about your kids. You raised them in a Christian household. You tried to be a good example to them, and now they're off in the world somewhere doing stuff that you hope they'd never get to experience, never have to experience. You think, what am I going to do? I tried to do everything right. I raise up a child in the way he should go, and now look, it's not working. What do we do, Lord? God says, oh, I can handle that. Or maybe you're facing some health challenges, or someone that you care about, someone that you love, is facing some health challenges. And you've tried everything. You've done all the scans, you've done all the tests, you've tried all the treatments, and it just doesn't look like there's any hope. Can God step in and still work in a situation like that, yes or no? Yes, he can. So take your problems, take your challenges, take your perplexities to God. I don't know why you felt impressed to come to this seminar tonight, but I do know that God impressed you. Maybe because of what you're going through in life right now. Lord, I need some hope. Well, I'm here to tell you the Bible can give you hope as you get to know your Savior better. Amen? So spend some time with Jesus in prayer. Lift your prayers up to the courts of heaven and see if God doesn't do something amazing. Because, as I mentioned, that same God who answered Daniel's prayer 2,500 years ago can answer your prayer tonight as well. So after spending some time with God in prayer, God gave Daniel the very same dream that he had given to Nebuchadnezzar, as well as the interpretation. So the next day, Daniel went back to the king. Let's take a look at this in verses 27 and onward. We're in Daniel chapter 2. We're going to start in verse number 27, and we're going to read several verses. Daniel chapter 2 and verse number... Actually, I want to read verse 26. I love verse 26. So it's a little bit of humor that God inserts in the Bible. Look at this in verse 26. The king answered and said to Daniel, whose name was Belteshazzar, art thou able to make known unto me the dream which I have seen and the interpretation thereof? He says to Daniel, can you tell me the interpretation? Can you tell me the dream? Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said, look at this, the secret which the king hath demanded, cannot the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, the soothsayers show unto the king? Can't they tell you what the future holds, king? These people that you've trusted, these advisors of yours, can't they do it? Now, the answer, of course, we know is what? No, they can't. They can't. But look who Daniel gives the credit to. Verse 28. But there is a what? God in heaven that revealeth secrets and maketh known to the king Nebuchadnezzar what shall be in the latter days, that is the future. Thy dream and the visions of thy head upon thy bed are these. So let's take a look now at this dream as Daniel recounts it. We're starting in verse 29 here. Daniel says, as for thee, O king, thy thoughts came into thy mind upon thy bed. What should come to pass hereafter? And he that revealeth secrets maketh known to thee what shall come to pass. But as for me, this secret is not revealed to me for any wisdom that I have more than any living, but for their sakes that shall make known the interpretation to the king, and that thou mightest know the thoughts of thy heart. Now look at verse 31. Thou, O king, sawest, and behold, a great image. This great image, whose brightness was excellent, stood before thee, and the form thereof was terrible. This image's head was of fine gold, his breast and his arms of silver, his belly and his thighs of brass, his legs of iron, his feet part of iron and part of clay. Thou sawest till that a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon his feet that were of iron and clay, and brake them to pieces. Then was the iron, the clay, the brass, the silver, and the gold broken to pieces together, and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors, and the wind carried them away, that no place was found for them. And the stone that smote the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. Now I want you to imagine for a moment the look on Nebuchadnezzar's face when Daniel tells him exactly what he dreamed the other night. What do you think his face looked like? What do you think his eyes looked like? Just bulging, bugging out of his head, right? What do you think his mouth looked like? Just jaw dropped on the floor, right? How do you think he was sitting on the throne? Do you think he was reclined, crossing his legs? What do you think he was like on his throne? He's leaning forward, his neck is craned, and he's thinking, that sounds like it, right? Now, I want you to notice what Daniel says in verse number 36. Daniel says, this is the dream. Was he confident that he had the right dream, yes or no? Yes. Why was he confident? Who'd he get it from? He got it from God. So he says, this is the dream. Now, if it was me in front of Nebuchadnezzar and I just told him what I thought he dreamed the other night, I'd have probably, when I finished, I'd have probably taken a couple steps back and gone, was that it? Did I get it right? Right. But no, not Daniel. Daniel said what? He said, this is the dream. He was confident. He got it directly from God. Now look what he says. He says, and we will tell the interpretation thereof before the king. So, what was the interpretation? You know that if Daniel told the king what he had dreamed, the next question out of the king's mouth, after saying, yeah, that was what I dreamed, would have been what? The king would want to know what? What does it mean? What does it represent? So Daniel tells him, verse number 37, you, O king, are a king of kings, for the God of heaven has given you a kingdom, power, strength, and glory. And wherever the children of men dwell, or the beasts of the field and the birds of the heaven, he has given them into your hand and has made you ruler over them all. You are this head of gold. Daniel tells Nebuchadnezzar, you, Nebuchadnezzar, your kingdom of Babylon, you are the head of gold. So we don't have to guess or speculate what the different parts of this image, what the parts of this vision represent, this dream represent. We don't have to guess. We just let Daniel tell us, because God is the one who's telling Daniel. So God says, you, Nebuchadnezzar, you, your kingdom of Babylon, you are represented by the head of gold. And it fitly represented the kingdom of Babylon because, as I mentioned, Babylon was a ridiculously wealthy kingdom. They had so much gold that silver was of virtually no value whatsoever. It was an incredibly powerful, influential, and wealthy kingdom. And Nebuchadnezzar was very proud of the kingdom that he had built. In fact, the bricks that were used to make the buildings and the walls and the streets, Nebuchadnezzar had them engraved with his name on the bricks. This is a brick from the kingdom of Babylon, a 2,500-year-old brick that I am holding, and it has Nebuchadnezzar's name inscribed on it right here. That's the name of Nebuchadnezzar on a brick from Babylon, 2,500 years old. So is there archaeological evidence that the stories that we're reading in the Bible are accurate, yes or no? Yes, there is. You can hold it in your hands. It is reliable. So an inscription on a stone that Nebuchadnezzar had engraved said this. Said the whole earth was prostrate at Babylon's feet. Babylon, the city which is the delight of my eyes, which I have glorified, may it last forever. How long did he want his kingdom to last? Forever. Did it last forever? No, it didn't. Because in this dream, there was a little bit of bad news for the king. Because in Daniel 2, verse 39, Daniel tells him, but after you shall arise another what? Kingdom inferior to yours. So Daniel is telling the king, each of these metals in the image represents a different kingdom. You represent, the head of gold represents the kingdom of Babylon, but after you would come another kingdom. What kingdom was that? It was the joint kingdom of Medo-Persia or Media-Persia. That's the one that came after that. Now, this was a kingdom of silver. Well, how did this come to pass? If Babylon was so powerful and influential, how did another kingdom come and overthrow it? Keep a finger or a marker here in Daniel 2 and go over to Daniel chapter 5. Go over to Daniel chapter 5. I'm going to share very quickly a story. This is the story of the handwriting on the wall. We're reading a story here of Nebuchadnezzar's grandson, Belshazzar. Belshazzar was ruling at this time, at the time that Daniel 5 takes place. And his kingdom, Babylon, was under siege by the Medes and the Persians. They had the city surrounded. Belshazzar was not concerned. What did he care if they had surrounded the city? Usually a surrounded city meant a siege and starvation and death for the ones who were inside. Belshazzar wasn't concerned about that. Why was he not concerned? They had all the water they wanted from what? The river Euphrates. They had all the food that they needed from what? From the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. In fact, historians tell us that the soldiers, the Babylonian soldiers, stood up on the walls of the city of Babylon, which they considered to be unbreakable. They stood up on the walls of the city and they threw food down to the army outside. They said, you want to starve us out? Hope you're prepared to wait a long time. We've got lots and lots of food in here. So they were not concerned at all. In fact, so little concern that Belshazzar decided to have a banquet. And you read this in Daniel chapter 5. He invited 1,000 of his lords and ladies to this banquet. And in the excitement, he decided to call for the holy vessels that his grandfather had stolen from the temple in Jerusalem. He called for them to be brought out, to be filled with wine, so that he could drink toasts to his own gods, the gods of gold and stone and silver and wood. And as he did so, in that moment of blasphemy, a hand appeared out of nowhere, and it began to write on the wall of the banquet hall. And he couldn't understand what it was written, but he was scared. So he called for his wise men to come and help him. How has that worked up to this point? Not real well. But he called for his wise men. He said, whoever can read that, I will give them great reward. The wise men looked at it. They said, we have no idea what it says. But then somebody said, you know, in a difficult spot some years ago, there was a man who could help your grandfather. His name was Daniel. He's still alive. He's a little bit older now. But if you want, maybe you can call for him. And so they called for Daniel. And Daniel came in and Belshazzar said, if you tell me what the writing on that wall is, I know it's important, but if you can tell me what it is, I will make you the next ruler in the kingdom, third ruler in the kingdom. I'll give you great reward, riches beyond your dreams. Daniel looked at the handwriting on the wall, and he says, I can read that for you, but you can keep your reward. You want to know what it says? It says, the party is over. Okay, not exactly. But if you look in your Bible, you'll see what it does say. Look at verse number 25, Daniel 5, verse 25. The words on the wall were, mini, mini, tekel, upharsin. What did they mean? Verse 26, this is the interpretation. Mini, God has numbered thy kingdom and finished it. Tekel, thou art weighed in the balances and art found wanting. Perez, thy kingdom is divided and given to who? The Medes and the Persians. That very night, the kingdom of Babylon fell. How? Because prior to that evening, the army had been digging a new route, a new direction for the river Euphrates to flow upriver from the city. That night they finished it and diverted the flow of the river Euphrates into a nearby plain or valley. That caused the water level of the river Euphrates inside the city of Babylon to fall. Now the army was able to walk, to march down into the now dry riverbed underneath the exterior walls of the city of Babylon, up into it where they had left the gates open because they didn't expect anybody was going to try that, and they overthrew the kingdom with hardly even a fight. If you go to the British Museum in London, England, and go to Persian Hall, what you will find there is something called the Cyrus Cylinder. The Cyrus Cylinder is a rock record of this very battle. What I have here is a cast from the original. This is what it looks like. This is the story of the overthrow of the kingdom of Babylon, exactly as it appears in the Bible. What does that mean? Well, among other things, it means you can trust what you see in your Bible. Because in the museums of the world, you find evidence for what the Bible says did indeed happen. Let's see what happens after that. Daniel 2, verse 39. Then another, Daniel says, a third kingdom of bronze which shall rule over all the earth. This was the kingdom of Greece. Now you can read about Greece in Daniel chapter 8, verses 20 and 21. So God names these kingdoms. We just read about Media and Persia over there in Daniel chapter 5. Then we see the kingdom of Greece over in Daniel chapter 8, verses 20 and 21. God actually names these different kingdoms. It would be the next world ruling empire. Alexander the Great stretched his empire far and wide during his relatively brief rule. Then in Daniel 2, verse 40, it says, and a fourth kingdom shall be as strong as what? Iron, inasmuch as iron breaks in pieces and shatters everything, and like iron that crushes, that kingdom will break in pieces and crush all the others. That was the kingdom of what? Rome. Rome was the next world ruling empire or the world ruling power. You can read about Rome all through the New Testament. So all through this, God is predicting the rise and fall of world empires. Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, Rome. Of course, the Caesars ruled for many, many years, and they conquered the Greek Empire. Now, if you were to guess how the kingdom of Rome would fall, what has been the pattern so far? One kingdom comes and conquers another. It rises up and another one does what? Conquers it. The next one comes and conquers it. If you were to guess how Rome was going to fall, you would probably guess that it would be conquered. But you look back at history, Rome was not conquered. Rome was divided. It kind of disintegrated from the inside out. So in order for the Bible to be accurate, it would have to depict that Rome was divided. Well, take a look at Daniel 2, verse 41. It says, whereas you saw the feet and toes, partly of potter's clay and partly of iron, the kingdom shall be what? It shall be divided. Yet the strength of the iron shall be in it, just as you saw the iron mixed with ceramic clay. So this feet of iron and clay represent the 10 divisions of the Roman Empire. Now, not all 10 divisions are still there today, still in existence today. Some of them are, though. These are the 10 divisions of the Roman Empire. The Alemanni, they eventually became what we know today as the Germans. The Franks, they're the French. The Visigoths, those, of course, are the Spanish. The Suevi are the Portuguese. The Lombards, they're the Italians. The Burgundians eventually became the Swiss, the Anglo-Saxons became the British, and then you have three other people groups who are no longer in existence today. They are the Heruli, the Vandals, and the Ostrogoths. Those three people groups are extinct today. Now, some of you may be thinking right now, well, Eric, this is a really interesting history lesson and all, but what does this have to do with the United States in our day, with the future of where this country is going? It has a lot to do with it. Remember what I promised at the beginning? Tonight and tomorrow night, we're laying the what? The foundation. There are many people today who believe that the Antichrist is going to rise from somewhere in Europe. We're looking at the 10 tribes that populated Europe, and three of them that are no longer in existence. The future of the United States and the Antichrist are going to come together. And on Monday night, we're going to find the identity of the Antichrist beyond any shadow of a doubt. You're going to be absolutely amazed. And many of you are going to go, I had a feeling that might be the case. Some of you already know it because you've studied. But on Monday night, we're going to pull together the identity of the Antichrist. What we're looking at tonight is laying the foundation for our study of the Antichrist on Monday night. And we're going to see how the Antichrist and the United States come together in Bible prophecy. So here, let's go back to Daniel chapter 2 again. Daniel chapter 2, verse number 42. It says, as the toes of the feet were part of iron and part of clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and what? Partly broken. Does that kind of describe the nations of Europe today? Some nations that are strong and some nations that are weak, some that are broken, some that aren't. And then it says in verse number 43, and whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay. It says they're going to mingle themselves with the seed of men. What's that talking about? That's talking about intermarriage. If you look back at Europe during the 1200s, 13, 14, 1500s, you have many different kingdoms over there. And there was always an effort and a desire to expand one's own kingdom. And if it couldn't be done militarily, or you didn't want to do it militarily, there was another way to unite empires. What was that through? Marriage. So if you could get, if you were the king of this nation, this kingdom, and you had a son who was a prince, you'd look over at that neighboring kingdom and maybe there was a what? A princess over there. And so you try to marry your prince with their princess or your princess with their prince and to try to bring the nations together. And at some points, there were kings and queens who were essentially the grandparents of almost all the nations throughout Europe. Many attempts to do that. But Europe never did reunite through marriage, through the mingling of the seed of men. So others tried to do it militarily. You think of Napoleon, he tried, Stalin, Hitler. There were many different attempts by people to reunite Europe militarily. Are some of those attempts going on today? Yes, they are. But there is something that has stopped every would-be world ruler, every dictator over in Europe from accomplishing their designs, their plans. You know what has stopped them? Take a look at verse 43. There are seven words there that stopped all of them. It says, they shall not cleave one to another. That has stopped every single one of them. God has said they will try, they will give it their best effort, they'll do their best. At times it may look like they're going to succeed. It looked like Napoleon was going to succeed until he didn't. It looked like Hitler was going to succeed until he didn't. In fact, I'll share with you a story, a true story from World War II. It's of a German pastor who was drafted into the German military, as many young men were back in those days. He served in his unit that was sent out to the Eastern Front to fight the Russians. True story. They faced terrible, terrible opposition. The casualties were through the roof. But all through this, the soldier, whose name was Pastor Franz Hasel, continued to study his Bible, continued to pray, continued to commune with God. As the war continued, they were facing stiffer and stiffer opposition from the Russians. And the commander of Hasel's unit was concerned about where things were going. And so he invited Hasel to come into his headquarters tent to have a little talk with him. He said, "I know you study the Bible. I know you're into the prophecies of the Bible. I want you to tell me, is Hitler going to succeed or not?" Now, you can imagine being a soldier in the German army being asked that question. Now, wisdom would tell you to say what? Yes, absolutely. No question. He's going to succeed. But Hasel served the God of heaven. And so they had a little system set up in their unit that if you wanted to speak off the record without any fear of repercussions or ramifications, you would take your hat off to have the conversation. So Hasel asked his commanding officer, he says, "Is this an official question or an unofficial question?" His commander took his hat off. He could speak freely. So what did Hasel do? He opened his Bible to the book of Daniel chapter 2. And he began to walk through the very same prophecy that we've looked at tonight. The very same ones. Talked about Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, Rome, the rise of the different nations in Europe and the dividing of Europe, and that they would not cleave one to another. And he said, based on the Bible, which is reliable, Hitler will not succeed. We are going to lose. His commanding officer sat there quiet for a few moments and said, "May I have your Bible?" He handed it to him. He said, "I want you to come back and see me again tomorrow morning." And he dismissed Hasel. The next morning, Hasel came back again. He walked into the tent, and his commanding officer was there with two other men. And he said to Hasel, "I want you to share with me exactly what you shared with me yesterday. Don't leave anything out. Exactly what you shared with me." And Hasel took his Bible again, went through it, gave exactly the same study that we just went through tonight. And as that was going on, Hasel noticed that from time to time, his commanding officer would look at one of the men, and then the other man, and each man would nod his head as he continued. When Hasel finished, his commanding officer told him, "Thank you for sharing that with me, with us. You may leave." And as Hasel turned to leave, his commanding officer said, "Hang on a second. I want to tell you who these two men are. This man, prior to the start of the war, was a professor of history at the German university. He has confirmed everything that you have told me. This man was a teacher of history in a German high school prior to the war. He has also confirmed everything that you have told me. Thank you, you may go." And he took his Bible and he left. Not long after that, the war came to an end. You, of course, know Germany lost. But Hasel's unit was far to the east over in Russia and had a long, long way to go to get back home. But when the war came to an end, Hasel's unit was ready to go back. They had all the fuel that they needed. They had all the food that they needed to make the long journey back to Germany. Why? Because Hasel's commander, from the time that Hasel had shared that with him, had begun to stockpile and squirrel away fuel and food that he knew they would need to make it home. So you tell me, is it important to understand the prophecies of the Bible, yes or no? Yes. In fact, it could very well save your life. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 46, verses 9 and 10, it says, "Remember the former things of old, for I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times, things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. There's one other thing that we need to take a look at this evening as we're studying this prophecy. You may remember that there were this multi-metalled man, but then something happened. Do you remember what happened at the end of that dream? Something came. What came? It was a stone, a rock. Do you know what that rock represents? That represents Christ's eternal kingdom. Have you ever heard said, rock of ages cleft for me? That's Jesus. His kingdom is coming. And the Bible says his kingdom is going to last how long? It's going to last forever. Take a look at Daniel 2, verses 44 and 45. It says, and in the days of these kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people. It shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand how long? Forever. Inasmuch as you saw that the stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, and that it broke in pieces the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the great God has made known to the king what will come to pass after this. The dream is certain, and its interpretation is what? It is sure. There was a poem that was written a number of years ago that kind of reminds me of what we've looked at this evening. It's called The Anvil, and it goes something like this. Last eve I paused beside the blacksmith's door and heard the anvil ring the vesper chime. Then looking in upon the floor, I saw old hammers worn with beating years of time. How many anvils have you had, said I, to wear and batter out those hammers so? Just one, said he, and then with twinkling eye, the anvil wears the hammers out, you know. And so I thought the anvil of God's word, for ages skeptics' blows have beat upon. But though the sound of falling blows is heard, the anvil still remains, the hammer's gone. The Bible is an anvil that has worn out many, many hammers. It has stood the test of time. It is archaeologically, historically accurate, and it changes people's lives. So, if we can trust the Bible, what does it say about the future of this country? Who's going to come out on top, the Republicans or the Democrats? Is it going to be the independents? Is it going to be the Greens? Is it going to be blue? Is it going to be red? What does the future of this great country hold? Well, if you want to know, what's one thing you need to keep doing? Keep coming. Because we've laid part of the foundation tonight. We're going to lay more of the foundation tomorrow night. Then Sunday night, we're looking at the United States in Bible prophecy. Monday night, we are taking a look at the rise of the Antichrist, and you are going to see a great many things come together very, very clearly. And what you see happening in the world today, and all the strife and all the persecution and all the injustice, all of that is going to start making a whole lot more sense very, very soon. So what are we looking at tomorrow night? Tomorrow night is prophecy's final one world power. You don't want to miss tomorrow night. So I'm going to invite you to bow your heads with me as we close this evening with prayer. Father, we want to thank you for your word, that you have preserved it down through time, that we may have hope, that we may have encouragement in very, very difficult times. And we ask that you will give us the hope, give us the encouragement that we may latch on to so that we can face the future with a great deal of confidence. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.